We're going to go ahead and dive straight into our message this morning. We're in week number two of a series called Strapped, okay? And obviously, it's kind of, you can tell it's about money, okay? We're going to take the next couple more weeks. We're taking 4 weeks to really dive into what Scripture says about finances and what Scripture says about how we deal with the resources we have in our life and to learn some how to manage money with wisdom, all right? You know some people. I'm certainly that you don't fall into this category, but I know that you know some people that when they manage money, they don't manage money with wisdom. Can I get an amen? All right, a few of you know those people. So I want to take just a couple of minutes before I get into today's message. I want to review, so to speak, if you happen to miss last week's message. Now, if you did, go back and watch that, www.skyline.church, our website. You can go back and watch the whole message. But this morning, I want to give you a little Cliff Notes version of that message because it kind of sets the stage for what we're talking about today. Proverbs chapter 22, verse number 7 was a key verse for us, and it said, just as the rich rule the poor, so the borrower is servant to the lender, okay? Who is the borrower? It's a person that is getting themselves into debt, okay? That borrower is what? Okay, try it again. Borrower is what?
Servant.
To who? The lender. The borrower is servant to the lender. And we learned last week that the Hebrew term there, the word servant, is the term ebed. And it doesn't just mean a butler or a maid. It literally means a slave. We're talking about somebody, if you're in debt, you are a slave to your lender. You are in bondage. You are strapped, okay? And what you've got is you've got a tourniquet. Now, I was going to pull my belt off, and I realized that might not be a good thing. But what happens with a tourniquet, you got, let's say you cut your arm and that you're bleeding out, okay? That's what debt does to you. That's what we do with our money. Our money just bleeds. And that tourniquet, while on one hand we think, man, this can save our life. The tighter it gets, eventually that arm's going to fall off, right? And that's kind of what debt does, is it cuts off the blood supply of life into our financial world, okay? When we don't place limits on how we handle our money, it begins to cut off the lifeblood to our world, right? You say, well, Lance, I'm not a slave to money. Nobody ever says that. Nobody says I'm a slave to my money. I'm not a slave to my debt. But what do you say? You say, well, Pastor, I would love to do this, or I would love to do that, but since I don't have any cash, since I'm strapped, I can't. I'd love to get a different job, but I can't afford it. I'd love to have more children, but I can't afford it. I'd love to get married, but guess what? I can't afford it. I'd love to go on a mission trip. I'd love to go to Honduras, or I'd love to go to Florida and help out Lighthouse Ministries this summer, but I just don't have the money. I'm strapped. That's what you're saying. You're saying I'm strapped for cash. You know what you're saying? You're saying I'm in bondage to my resources, okay? We also learned last week, Jesus talked a lot about money in the Gospels. And one of the particular verses that we quoted last week was where Jesus says, you cannot serve two masters. He says, you're going to love the one and hate the other, but you can't serve both. And then what did he say? He said, you can't serve both God and what? And money. Now, he could have said 100 things. He could have said, you can't serve both God and power. He could have said, you can't serve both God and popularity. But he chose money. Now, why did he choose money? He chose money because he knows how important it is to our life. And he understands that money is the one thing that competes for our heart bigger than any other thing in our life. Okay? And the last thing that we learned last week is we learned that as Christian people, we do not serve money. Who do we serve? Let's try that again. We are not to serve money. Who do we serve?
God.
There you go. This is a crowd participation thing today, okay? All right. If we are allowing ourselves to dive deeper and deeper into debt, we are a slave to our money. We serve money, but we don't serve money, right? We serve who? And as we serve God, who does money serve? Oh, wait, two of you listened. Good. As we learn to serve God, money serves us, right? You can let money be your master, but if you learn to master money, it will serve you, okay? Believe it or not, Scripture teaches us how that works, okay? And so, but here we are, as a nation, maybe as a people. I don't know all of your financial situations. I know some of them. But here we are, and we are in debt. We are slaves to our money, right? Well, why are we in debt? A lot of times we're in debt because we're trying to be something that we're not with money that we don't have, okay? A lot of times we want to appear richer than what we really are. A lot of times, and you know, I hear older people complain about today's generation. Like millennials, how many millennials do we have in the house today? I realize some of you got a bad rap, okay? There's a lot of us older folks, and we get down on you millennials a lot. But guess what? There was a lot of people that were down on us when we were your age, right? But that's kind of the older generation always kind of looks back at the younger generation. It's like, those young whippersnappers, okay? But it's true. There's a lot of entitlement inside of our hearts as young adults because we see what mom and dad have, and we want what mom and dad had, failing to realize that it took them 40 years to get there. And we want it now, and because we want it now, because we feel entitled for it, we buy things that we're not ready for, and we borrow to get the stuff. And we got the stuff, but we've also got the debt that comes along with the stuff. And because we've got the debt, guess what? We are strapped. We're tying our hands when it comes to our life. And I want to look at some wisdom from Scripture this morning. In Proverbs, we're going to spend a lot of time in Proverbs over this series. So if you've never read the book of Proverbs and you're in financial trouble, go read it. There's lots of stuff in there. But Proverbs verse 13, or chapter 13, verse 7, it says, some who are poor pretend to be rich. And that's kind of who we are, okay? And in our country, I guess this is all over the world, but especially in the United States, there's three groups of people. You got the haves, and you got the have-nots, and you got to have not paid for what they got. Those are the pretenders. That's who this verse is talking about. Some who are poor pretend to be rich. Those people are in bondage. Maybe you're in bondage today. Maybe you've been in bondage and you've heard everything that I've said. And you're like, amen, pastor. I know I've been there. I've lived in that moment. And so we want to kind of walk through this whole debt thing from the standpoint of Scripture so that you can see that even though you've been spending all this time digging this hole and it's getting deeper and deeper, there's a way out. Believe it or not, God's word, you know, God's word is all about salvation through Jesus Christ, and that's the most beautiful thing about the gospel, and that's why we exist. But the Bible is so much deeper. It covers every part of our life, even the stuff that we carry. Well, we don't really carry it in here anymore. Even the stuff that we carry on this, okay? This is a debit card, not a credit card, by the way. But we're going to learn some principles today about debt. We're going to look at some values that we need to hold on to if we want to get out of debt. How many people would like to be out of debt today? Raise your hand. Okay, bunches and bunches of you. Some of you are out of debt, and go you, okay? If you're out of debt, encourage some of these people that are struggling to get out themselves, and we're going to help them along, and we're going to learn some values today. And the three things that I want to talk about are actually values that can impact every single area of your life. But if you want to get out of debt, now if you don't, this means nothing to you. You can just keep on digging, keep on digging. You can keep digging your hole as much as you want, okay? That's up to you. But if you want to get out of debt, these three things that I want to share with you today are absolutely essential for you to be victorious in that journey. All right, who's ready? You ready to go? All right, here we go. First value that we're going to learn to embrace, we're going to embrace the value of self-control. All right, self-control. Everybody say that with me. Self-control. All right, you guys have got this. All right, good. We're going to have a great day today. Look at what Scripture says. Again, Proverbs chapter 25, verse number 28. A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. A person that lacks what? A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. Okay, we've been hearing a lot of talk about walls lately, haven't we? But back in the biblical day, walls were necessary. Walls were a part of defense because there were a lot of bad people that wanted to come in and steal your stuff, okay? And so with a person that lacks self-control, it's like a city with broken down walls. And what I'm talking about, if you are a person that has no self-control when it comes to the financial matters inside of your world, you're like a city with no walls. You're defenseless. You're vulnerable for things that lack of finances can bring into your life. You're vulnerable to trouble that the world can bring on to you. You are vulnerable to diving yourself deeper and deeper into debt. And without self-control when it comes to your finances, you're going to end up in big, big trouble. Maybe not at first. Maybe it feels like, I'm doing okay. It's just a little bit. It's just a little bit. And then a little bit becomes a little more and a little more. And before you know it, you're strapped. And you can't make ends meet. And you've got more going out than you have coming in. And you're in trouble. You see, some of you nickel and dime it to death. And a lot of you ladies, you're guilty, okay? Let's just be honest. You got to get the belt that goes with the shirt, that went with the shoes that you got for 20% off, okay? And I'm sort of trying to be funny, but not really. I mean, honestly, that's part of the progression in how we nickel and dime a little deeper into debt. And your Kohl's card gets bigger and bigger, and your Target card gets bigger and bigger, and you know your Macy's card gets bigger and bigger, and before you know it, you've mounted up all of this debt, okay? So some of you nickel and dime it, but some of you are like guys, okay? Guys don't nickel and dime it. We just do it all in one shot. Hey, honey, come here. I told Chris, I was like, man, I really wish you brought your guitar because there's a country song. It goes something like this. It can buy me a boat. It can buy me a truck to pull it. It can buy me a Yeti 110 ice down with them. Yeah, some of you know that song. Some of you know that song, right? But that's how we do. It's like we just go big. Guys like big toys. Girls love sales. Guys like big toys. But what happens is we get ourselves into debt. Why? Because we don't have self-control, right? We want to get out of debt. We've got to have self-control, and we got to learn to say no. Let's practice that. I want some passion this morning. So everybody say that with me. Ready?
No.
Woo! You guys are good. I like that, all right? Say it like you mean it. Ladies, I want you to practice with me this morning. Can you do that? Do you need your nails done twice a month?
No.
I heard a yes out there. I already talked to one person that told me they got their nails done twice a month, right? Let's try it again. Ladies, do you need to have your nails done twice a month?
No.
I still heard the yes. Listen, if you're trying to get out of debt, the answer is no. If you're trying to get out of debt, the answer is no. Nails aren't that big a deal. You know who you do your nails for? It's not for guys. When's the last time you ever had a guy walk by and look at the set of nails on that girl? You do it for your own girlfriends, right? Because they look pretty. Guys don't care. Ladies, do you need your nails done twice a month?
No.
No. All right, guys, let's practice with you. Do you need to play golf every single week? Listen, I'm praying for all y'all. Try it again. Guys, do you need to play golf every single week?
No.
If you're trying to get out of debt, no, you don't need to do that. Not everybody likes to play golf. I do. But you know what a lot of us love? Coffee. How many, do you really need that $4 cup of caffeine go juice every single morning that you drive out of your way on your way to work to buy?
No.
No. Some of you didn't say anything. Like, I'm afraid to speak. Do you really need that brand new car that's going to depreciate 20% as soon as you drive it off the lot?
No.
No. Now, understand what I'm telling you here. You're like, Pastor's killing my fun. No, I'm not telling you that at all. All right? I'm not telling you not to enjoy those things. I'm not telling you that you can never experience those things. When you get out of debt, you save your cash. And you go buy that new car. Buy one for your mother-in-law. I don't care. Get the butt warmers. It's all good. Ladies, get your nails done every single week. Guys, go play golf. Knock yourself out. When you get out of debt, go enjoy those kinds of things. But only when you get out of debt. And the only way that you're going to get out of debt is by learning to say no. Self-control. We're going to say no for a little while, so that we can say yes for the rest of our life. Wouldn't you love to be in that place?
Yes.
Yes. See, now you can try that. Let's try that. Wouldn't you like to be in that place?
Yes.
See, now we can say yes because we learn to say no, and that takes self-control. So here's the second value we need to embrace, okay? We embrace self-control, but we're also going to learn to embrace sacrifice. Jesus exemplified this for us, right? Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 2. He says, we do this, talking about running our race of life, by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Woo! And what does this have to do with money? This has nothing to do with money necessarily. It has everything to do with sacrifice. He says, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured, he sacrificed on the cross, disregarding its shame. Well, what was his joy? His joy was pleasing his Father because he knew that enduring the cross and disregarding its shame would open up a door. It would open up a door for you and me to enter into a relationship with God so that we could spend eternity with him. And because of that joy, he was willing to endure the cross and disregard its shame. He gave us that access through a sacrifice. He gave up something that he loved. Jesus loved life. He embraced life. He made the most of life. Listen, he was just as much human as he was God. And he loved life just like you do. And he was willing to give up that life, something that he loved, for something that he wanted even more. And that was for us to be in a relationship with God. We defined it last week. That's what sacrifice is. It's giving up something that you love for something that you love even more. Now, I like watching TV, okay? Anybody like watching TV?
Yeah.
Who's a Walking Dead fan?
Yeah.
We got a few of you, okay, good. We're going to be in the same boat later, all right? I like cable TV. I like, we have U-verse, okay? I like U-verse. I love it. I love watching TV, right? But maybe you would really love to have a debt-free Christmas next year that you're not paying for next May. Some of you go into way big amounts of debt on Christmas time, and it takes you months to pay it off. And maybe you love cable TV, but you would love to have a debt-free Christmas a little bit more. And you know what? You're willing to sacrifice maybe a year of cable television so that you wouldn't have to buy that debt. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. Some of you love cable TV too much, okay? Maybe you're wanting a bigger house, right? Maybe you would love to have that extra space in your garage, or maybe that extra bedroom for your in-laws, but you're willing to give up something that you love for something that you really want more, because maybe you would like to be in a position where one of you could stay home with the kids and you could raise your kids. Maybe you'd like to homeschool your kids. You're not going to be able to do that in your current situation if you're trying to get a bigger home. You may have to sacrifice something that you want for something that you want even more. Now, I had y'all millennials raise your hand, okay? And some of you are in college. And I know a lot of you would love to go to school and get your degree without having to come out with what? Student loan debt. That's a killer. But here you are, you like your free time, and you're an introvert, and you want to be alone all the time. You just want to find your own little apartment, your little efficiency apartment, and you want to live there. But you also know that if I do that, I'm going to have to take on more debt because I can't afford it. What are you going to do? You're going to sacrifice something that you love for something you love even more. You're probably going to have to get out and get a part-time job. You're probably going to need to maybe invite some people to come and be roommates. Heaven forbid you be around people, but you're going to sacrifice something that you love for something that you want even more. And what is that? To get out of school debt-free. That would be a great goal for some of you. You see how sacrifice works in the financial world? Everything in your life, whether you want to take a vacation or whether you want to buy a new car or whether you want to buy a new computer, it doesn't matter. So let me kind of let you know how this can work, because we've talked about some big things. I realize that cable TV is a big sacrifice, okay? But there are some smaller things that we can sacrifice in our life that can actually make a humongous difference. Okay, is this close enough? Can everybody see this? Okay. Now, I know some of you, and I know how your world works. A lot of you work crazy busy hours, but you have a nice long lunch break and you like to go out to eat for lunch. And what do? You like to get a sandwich. And I don't know about your sandwiches, but I've seen them cost about $8. You get a good burger or whatever. You got to have a drink. A lot of you don't like water too much, so you get a soda. And those sodas aren't cheap anymore either. And that's $2. And you've just spent $10 every single day of your week, okay? Let's say that you work 5 days a week. $10 just blown right out the window. But what would happen if you decided, I don't want a car payment anymore? What would happen if you decided, I've got this credit card debt that I want to get rid of. How can I go about finding some money to be able to do that? I can tell you one way that you can do it is you can learn to brown bag it. You say, well, Lance, it's just 10 bucks. A lot more than 10 bucks. I already did the math, so I'm going to read it off my paper, okay? All right. So we have $10 a day, and you work 5 days a week, right? That's $50 a week. Hopefully, you got some vacation time, and so you're only going to be working 50 weeks out of the year, so you got $50 a week times 50 weeks a year. Does anybody want to do the math on that? All of a sudden, that $10 looks a little bigger, doesn't it? $2,500 that you saved in a year because you chose to brown bag. Can you say wow?
Wow.
Okay, well, let's get that wow a little bit bigger. Just a little sacrifice. You've already saved $2,500. All right, so I'm going to throw this over here. We're going to look at another big wow here in just a minute. Remember last week we talked about credit card statistics, and there are some people that carry credit card balances. All right, this is not counting people that pay their stuff off every single month, which that's really smart to do. But last week I shared with you that for people that carry a balance for credit cards, the average debt is about $14,517. I don't know about you. That's a lot of money on your credit card. And that's tough. You know what that is? That's, honey, we got to take the kids to Disneyland before they get too old. $7,000 gone. Maybe even more. Right? That's a baby. I need that new theater system for the apartment, right? $3,000 gone. Deeper and deeper and deeper. And before you know it, you end up with $14,000 in credit card debt. But here's the thing. We never count the cost. We always ask what the payment is, but we never think about what the cost is, all right? So let's just assume, and this number is probably a little bit low, but let's assume that we pay basically $217 a month. That's our minimum payment on that $14,000 debt. And let's say that we're sitting at about 18%, which is about average for credit card interest, all right? I had the help of some calculators on this one, so my numbers may or may not be right. But let's just say that we had that 18%. How long do you think it's going to take for you to pay that debt off?
The rest of your life.
Not 5 or 7 or 8. It's going to take you just shy of 20 years to pay $14,000 off. Maybe you could afford the payment, but what is the cost? You know how much that's going to cost you? By the time you paid it all off, over $50,000. That's crazy, right? It's pretty pricey. But let's say that we were out of debt and we took the same $14,000 and we invested it at, say, 12% interest, all right? That might be a little high, it might be a little low, but just for the sake of numbers. In that same 20-year window, instead of having paid out $50,000, now you have over $177,000 that you have in your pocket. See how things begin to turn around? But let's say you were really good and you waited for 40 years. You invested that money for 40 years. You know what that number is going to turn into? $1,957,000 or $704. That is a game changer because you chose to follow strong biblical principles. Get your rear end out of debt and start managing your money the way that God has said that you need to manage it. Let's say that you took that same credit card debt, and on top of that, you started putting in what would have been the minimum payment for that credit card. After 20 years at 12% interest, you would have had $372,796. And after 40 years, that number wouldn't even be 1.9. It would be $4.275 million. Can you say wow?
Wow.
Because you learn to manage your money in a way that honors God. How much more of a difference in the world could you make if you chose today to start managing your money in this way? And you chose today that you're going to sacrifice for a little while. You're going to say no for a little while so that you can say yes for the rest of your life. Imagine how different your world would be. Imagine how many people that you could help if you chose to break the mode of normal in this world and to be abnormal in honor and glory of God by choosing to sacrifice and to practice self-control. It's huge. There's one more value I want to share with you, and it's simply planning. We're going to embrace the value of planning. Proverbs chapter 21, verse number 5 says, good planning and hard work lead to prosperity, but hasty shortcuts lead to poverty. You know what credit card debt is? It's hasty shortcut. What does it say about good planning and hard work? What does it lead to?
It went away.
What? Where's my scripture at? There it is. What?
Prosperity.
Whoa. This is not a prosperity gospel church. Now, I'm not telling you you're going to plant a seed of 1,000. God's going to give you a million. No. What does the Bible say? It says good planning and hard work lead to what? This is God speaking to you today. Good planning and hard work lead to prosperity. Here's the deal. You can wander into debt, but you can't wander out of it. You can't wander out of it. It's going to take planning and it's going to take hard work. Now, there's one thing that I could spend an entire message on, and it's something called a budget and learning how to build a budget. You know what a budget is? It's basically telling your money where to go and what to do. All right? It's learning to master your money, right? So I could go into that, but we've actually got some resources for that. We've got some financial coaches here in the church, and if you need some help building a budget to learn how to manage that money, go stop at the Red Tent, see Dennis. He'll get you hooked up with a great financial coach to walk you through that process. I'd also recommend a guy named Dave Ramsey, a lot of you are familiar with. He has this book called Financial Peace University, in which we use a lot of those principles in our own life, and those are huge, and they can help you to learn to budget and all of that stuff. But today, I want to kind of talk about two things in particular when it comes to our debt, okay? First thing that we're going to talk about today is simply an emergency fund. This is straight out of Dave Ramsey's book. And Dave Ramsey says that you need to save $1,000 for an emergency fund. You say, well, Lance, I'm trying to get out of debt. Why do I need to have an emergency fund? Because things break. Your car is going to break. Your washer and dryer is going to break. Your kid's going to break. I don't know the last time you went to a mechanic, but mechanics aren't cheap. Last time you went to the emergency room, did they do stuff for free? Nope. It's expensive. You need that emergency fund. You need to save at least $1,000 just to have an emergency fund. You say, well, Lance, I'm strapped. I don't know where to get it. Where am I supposed to get that? I don't know, but you'll find it. You'll go through all of your junk and you'll sell some stuff on eBay or Craigslist. You might go out and get a part-time job, or you may do a side job of some sort. I don't know where you're going to find that $1,000, but I believe in you enough to know that you can do it. But once we've got that $1,000, we need to start tackling the debt that's in our life. And how are we going to do that? We're going to do that with something that Dave Ramsey calls the debt snowball. All right, and I want to kind of walk through this with you today, and we're going to try to breeze through this if you're taking notes today. We've got a lot of debt in our life. We owe Lowe's, let's see my numbers here, at 18%, that's a credit card, and we owe them $450 per month, okay? Minimum payment is going to be 50, all right? So let's go down the list here. We've got Target at 18%, another credit card, and we owe Target $650. Their minimum payment, we'll say, is $30 a month. Your parents, God bless those parents, and their interest-free loans. Anybody took an interest-free loan out from a parent? I have. Been there and done that. Let's say that we owe them $1,600 and we try to pay them $200 a month. Then you've got your Visa credit card that you put all your groceries on, and that's another 18% right there. And that Visa, we've stacked up an $1,800 bill there. And we're going to say we're going to pay $30 on that one. Then we've got a car. And let's say that our car is at 10%. We got a pretty good deal on that. We didn't get the 0% interest because your debt is crap. $7,000. Somebody got mad at me for saying that, but it's okay. And we're going to pay them $400 per month, all right? And last but not least, you didn't get that extra job and you didn't bring roommates in, so you have school loans. And let's just say that you still owe $9,000, and we're going to pay that $200 a month. So here's what I just did. I took all of my outstanding debt. I didn't put my house on there, okay? Almost everybody in here has a house payment. But I took all of my outstanding debt, and I listed that debt from the least down to the most. And we're going to snowball. You know what that means? That means as the snowball gets going, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, right? So here's what's going to happen. We're going to find $200 a month. Lance, where are we going to find it? I don't know. You found money to get the $1,000. Let's figure out a way to find $200 a month. Maybe it is giving up the cable. Maybe it is stopping the way that you eat out. Maybe it is, I don't know what it is. You're going to find a way to get this $200 per month, and you're going to add this to your stuff, all right? So we owe Lowe's $50 per month, but now we're going to put $200 on top of that. That means we're going to pay Lowe's $250 per month. And you know what that means? That means in 2 months, that debt is gone. But now we still have this one, $650, and we owe $30. But now, guess what? We've got $250. So we're going to take this money down here, $250 plus the $30, that's $280. How many months is it going to take there? 2.5, right? So 2.5 months. That one's gone. That's just 4.5 months, and you've already knocked out two of those. But look at what happens. Now, we have got $280, and we have the minimum payment of $200. So now we have $450. How long is it going to take us to pay this off? Say 4 months? We're just going to round up. We're going to make it big. That one's gone. Now we've got $480 plus $30. That's $510. 4 months, 3 months, 4 months, it's done. 4 months, that's gone. So now we've got $510 plus the $400. How long is it going to take us? That's $910. 6, 7 months, 8 months, 7 months. Let's call it 7 months. And that one's gone. Woo! 2, 4, 8. That's 1 year. 1.5 years. And we only have this left. But look at this. Now we have $910 a month plus the $200 that we're paying here. That's $1,110. Is that right? And let's just call it 8 more months. And just shade over 2 years. It's gone. And I want you to look at the beauty of this. At the end of that 2 years, guess what you've done to yourself? You have added $1,110 to your budget. 2 years. Okay? Now let's stop and think about this for just a minute. I'm going to try to run through this as quickly as I can. If you pay these minimum payments, you know how long it would take you to pay that debt off? 10 years. It would take you 10 years to pay all of that debt off, assuming that you didn't take on any more. Assuming, okay? But now, in almost 100 fewer weeks, you're out of debt instead of being in debt. You ready to buckle your seatbelt? I'm running through a lot of paper today, but it's okay. This is good stuff. Now we've got $1,110 extra every single month. Now, what are we going to do with that? So I'm going to Disney World. Not yet. We're being wise with our money, right? We're sacrificing. We're still practicing self-control, but we are also still planning. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to, as Christian people, we believe that the first part of our income should go to God. We practice the tithe. And so we're going to do the tithe. We're going to take 10% and we're going to bring it back to God. And so that's $111 that we're going to bring to God. All right? But we also want to be generous. One of our core values is radical generosity at our church. And you know what we're going to do with another 10%? We're going to give. You say, well, I've already given. No, you tithe. That's not giving. We're going to give 10%. Well, who am I going to give it to? I don't care. Go help somebody in need. You know, we just went through a building campaign. That was something that some of you gave extra above in your tithes and offerings. You got favorite charities that you love to support. Man, knock yourself out. Let's give an additional 10%. Right? Let's give it to charity. Let's enjoy half of it. How many would like to have an extra $500 in your budget every month to enjoy, to spend, right? So let's enjoy. And this might be blow money, this might be paying bills. I don't know what it is. But let's just call it $555. All right? We're gonna put that in our budget. But now we're going to save, right? We're going to take the other part of what we've been blessed with because we were wise with God's resources, and we are going to take and we are going to save, well, that's 50%, and we're going to save 30%, all right? Let's just say we have $333. I'm just doing this because, all right, but it works. And let's be conservative. Let's not even do a 12% interest rate. Let me change colors. Forget that. Let's just say we have 8%, okay? And let's say that the 10 years that it would have taken us to pay all that debt off, and we invested at 8%, we have now made $61,000 in 10 years. Let's say in 20 years, that number is going to be nearly $200,000, and in 40 years, the same money, okay, that we saved because we got out of debt, watch this, $1,162,506. Because you sacrificed, because you practiced self-control, and because you planned according to God's word. God's word is full of principles that can help your life. Listen to what Romans 13:8 says. It says, owe nothing to anyone except your obligation to love one another. Imagine how much more you could extend physical love to people if you had this at your disposal. Imagine how much more ministry that you could do. Don't even focus on this part. That's a blessing. That's what God's blessing you with. But imagine the difference that you could make. Because money is not merely something that provides food and clothing and shelter. Money is a tool that God has given you to share the gospel with the entire world. We do not serve money. Who do we serve? All right, we did that earlier. Let's try it again. We're ending. I know you guys are tired. Hang in there with me. We're almost there. We don't serve money. Who do we serve?
God.
And as we serve God, who does money serve?
Us.
It serves us. And this fires me up, guys, because listen, imagine, all right? Imagine how awesome your life would be if you never had to worry ever again about being strapped. Imagine how much more peaceful your life could be if you were in a position in life to where you never had to worry about that next payment, where it was going to come from. Imagine how amazing your life could be if you could pursue what God is calling you to do. And not having to be stuck in some job that you just struggle to get through just because you got to pay the bills. And listen, this is not God's magic money pixie dust, okay? This is God's principles of practicality for your life. And as we follow those things, God begins to bless those things. As we are faithful to God, God is faithful to you. There's no magic about this. It's God just simply telling you how to live your life. And the funny thing happens when we actually live life the way God says live it, good stuff happens. And it's not magical. God designed it that way. But the question is, will you take the challenge to live your life that way. So every head bowed and every head closed. There's two groups of people I want to speak with this morning. And one are the people that you're drowning in debt or you're getting real close. And I'm praying for you that God's going to speak to you, that you're going to take a stand this morning and that you're going to learn to climb out of debt. And again, we got financial coaches that would be more than happy to meet with you and to help you walk through that. But maybe that's you today. And I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand or anything like that, but I am going to pray for you in just a minute. But there's a more important group that I want to talk to you. There's a group of people in here today that you're not a Christ follower. And you come in today, first of all, you saw the pastors talking about money and you were always freaked out already. But then all of a sudden, pastor starts making some sense. And it's good. And it's things that you can use for your life. But I want you to understand that there's something more important that we deal with here as a church. And it is a debt. But it's not a financial one. It's a debt of sin that we all carry. You're carrying that debt with you. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, you're carrying that debt with you. But the beauty of it is that Jesus has already done the work for that debt. He's already paid it off. He already made the sacrifice so that your debt could be wiped clean. Something that we call salvation. It wasn't a monetary gift that he gave you. It was a gift of his life hanging on a cross. And I don't want to leave today without asking you to respond to that gift, because Jesus is saying, hey, you don't have to worry about that debt. I've already paid for it. Here it is. You can take it from me. And maybe that's you today. Maybe you need to make that decision. And if that's you, I'm going to pray for you here in just a moment. But I want to ask you to let us know that you're making that decision, whether it's on your connection card, on the very front of it, there's a little box that you can say, I'm giving my life to Christ today. Or whether you come up and see me, or whether you go to the red tent and talk to Dennis, it doesn't matter. But let us know that you're making that decision today, because there's nothing more important. No matter what money you have at your life or you don't have, there's nothing that's worth anything until Jesus is part of our life. But let's pray. Father, we come to you in this moment. And God, we just thank you for giving us your word to guide us in life. But more importantly, we're so thankful that you gave us your word. You gave us Jesus. That the ultimate debt in our life could be paid. And today, God, I certainly want to pray for those that may be struggling with financial debt, Lord, that you would, Lord, I don't want you just to magically pull them out, but give them the strength and the wisdom that they need to follow your principles, God, that at the end of the day, they can glorify what you've done in their life. Before all of us here, God, to be able to understand that the ultimate debt is paid through Christ. And God, maybe if there's one or two or five or 10 that are here today and they don't know Jesus, God, I'm praying your Holy Spirit would just work in their life. Lord, that they would come to the place, Father, that they know they need him, that they need you, that they would give their heart and life over today, that they would accept the sacrifice of Christ that paid the sin debt in their life. Father, as they do that, Father, we will rejoice and we will praise your holy name. For it is in the name of Jesus that we pray and ask these things. And everyone says, amen. Let's give him glory today. Come on.